say he was one of the easiest people to communicate with. I mean, doesn't seem to be anything hidden about him or anything. He wasn't worried about anything, and he wasn't so overconfident that he'd be one of those, you know, obnoxious kind of people telling you what the real great things are and what the lousy things were. I never heard him say a negative thing about anybody, you know, which is rare in jazz, you know. He never had that kind of personality. He never had that kind of perspective on things. And I think all he wanted to do was write good arrangements. I think that's all he wanted to do. I always remember we played a couple of Dizzy Gillespie tunes and some other things, and we had played a whole set. I had a great time, and Gary was great. Gary's a really good improviser, very lyrical and very gracious, and it was a joy playing with him. But however, in all those solo albums and his vibe playing is good, I still prefer hearing his arrangements, because that's where I think the real Gary McFarland is in those fantastic jazz arrangements where he arranges like no one else I've ever heard. It was pitch perfect in timbre and in rhythm and in the whole formal structure. And I think he just did that intuitively after a while. It took him a while to get there, and he must have worked on it very hard. The other thing he felt really strongly about was developing his own method of combining instruments in a jazz form. And he loved the Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie sound of unison, trumpet, and alto and stuff. And he also loved the Miles sound of those Cannonball and John Coltrane and Miles playing together. And he listened a lot to that and tried to figure out just what it was that made that sound like that and how you could differentiate between the two and how you could deal with a big band not just writing for the saxophone section, but maybe a few saxophones, a couple of trombones, and one trumpet here and there and stuff, make it sound more interesting. And that's what I think his real focus was. And he did it pretty much on his own. And in that way, he was a self-taught arranger, and that's why he sounds, you know, so different and so, you know, and he hit on something that just lasts. Have an image of someone walking around and playing, you know, or someone doing something on stage. It's much more dramatic. It's much more theater. Whereas the focusing on a good arranger is more abstract, you know. That's what I think makes it hard. It took me a long time to realize that music was also theater. And I used to resent the fact. I remember when I was like 12 or 13, I would look at pop singers and say, they really don't know what they're doing. They just look good and they're moving in front of the camera. If someone can find the old Prell commercial where they had the first, I think they had the first plastic container for hair shampoo that wouldn't break in the shower. And he not only did the music for it, but you can see him conducting the thing. You can see an image of Gary in that if someone has that old Prell commercial. Even when I play those old things in the Jerry Mulligan band he wrote, I mean, that sounds like yesterday. It does. I mean, there's something timeless about those, even though they fall into that old cultural pattern. This stands out as, like, you know, not a big band arrangement, it's something else. Thank you.